Alright everybody, welcome back to the Reflector channel. This is kind of a special video because I'm going to just be showcasing a telescope that I just came across recently, and I wanted to share some of the cool stuff that I found about this. Now, in a previous video, I talked about how you could buy a used telescope and fix it up. This particular telescope did not really need much fixing up at all. It just had a lot of dust on it. But this is a very special telescope, and it is the second that I've been able to work on that came from the 1980s. And let me talk a little bit more about this. This is a Celestron 80mm FirstScope. It was made in the, from what we can tell, the early 1980s. It was made in Japan and sold under the Celestron label here in North America. Much like the Meade 320 that I restored last year, it was made in Japan as well, and it was sold under the Meade name here in the United States. Now, this has some features that I want to talk to you about, and we'll start at the back end. Now, this comes with an 18mm ortho inch and a quarter, right? Inch and a quarter eyepiece. So this is something special. This is early 80s, and this was already coming with an inch and a quarter eyepiece. So this was not a low-end beginner telescope back when it came out. This comes with a 45-degree diagonal. I'm not quite sure. I'm used to seeing the 90s used for astronomical telescopes, but this is a Celestron brand diagonal, so I guess this is the one that it probably came with. But it works great, and I've had very good luck with it. I have a 90-degree Orion one that I can use at any point in time. This has a rack and pinion focuser. Now, if you've watched any of my videos, I sometimes will joke about the rack and pinion focusers being a little bit sloppy. This one has no slop, no slop at all. I'm super impressed, you know, almost 4 decades old, and this is still really rock solid. I did notice that there are 2 adjustment screws hidden under the base plate here under the viewfinder, and if you adjust those, they have a little, basically a block of wood that pushes down on here to keep everything nice and tight, which is an impressive way to do it. And so anyways, it's still working all these years later. It has a standard optical viewfinder here, and it's not corrected, so everything's upside down when you look through it, but that's not a huge problem. The crosshairs were perfectly fine. I didn't have to fix those. That's always a super bonus. Now, this has these 2 ring connectors. They're kind of odd. It's not exactly this modern-day Vixen mount, but it actually does say Vixen on the mount. So from what I can tell, this was actually made by Vixen in Japan in the 1980s. So I've had a chance to use this on the moon so far, and I have to say it's pretty amazing because it has no chromatic aberration. I'm so used to these refractors having just a tiny bit, but I've had really good luck with this Japanese-made telescope and the Meade 320 that I restored last year. They both had terrific optics. And, you know, I've always been told that basically if you want to get rid of chromatic aberration, you're going to have to go with a long refractor that has really good optics. And so what I've found from my 2 experiences with Japanese-made long refractors is that they have fantastic optics. But I also want to talk about this mount. I've not seen this anywhere. You may be familiar with this, but I am not used to this. So it's an alt-azimuth setup, right? I know all these flexible cables make it look like it's going to be an equatorial, but it's not. And so basically you get it close to where you want it to be, and you lock it in right here. This locks the azimuth. And then you have these flexible slow motion cables. They are for elevation and azimuth, as you can see. Pretty slick stuff. This gives you super fine grain control over elevation and azimuth. And it's somewhat limited, though, because it rides on this little threaded block that is riding on a screw head. So you probably have about, I'm guessing, plus or minus 10 degrees of adjustment. But also, it has the kind of enough friction so that you can adjust it by hand. Look at that. And then you can still do the slow motion altitude adjustment. So that's pretty darn slick. But anyways, I wanted to share this with you because I thought it was pretty neat. The only thing that was missing was the dust cover, and I was able to buy one of those from a really nice gentleman on cloudy nights on the classifieds, and it fits perfect. And so I've used it on the moon. I've used it on Venus a little bit, but unfortunately it was too low in the sky when I was looking at it. I look forward to using this on some other stuff. It does show Orion pretty well, but unfortunately here in my Borel 8 light pollution skies, it's hard to really see anything unless you have a larger scope. But all in all, I really love these Japanese-made 1980s refractor telescopes. So I got this on Facebook Marketplace. The person who was selling it was moving, and they just didn't have any room for it anymore, and they wanted to get rid of it, and they weren't really into astronomy. I think they may have inherited it from somebody, or maybe it was a gift long ago. I'm not quite sure. So if you're looking on your used marketplaces and you come across one of these Japanese-made 1980s vintage refractors, if it's a pretty good price, and I got this one for actually a pretty good price, so they are out there. And if you see one of these for a pretty good price, I would say go ahead and snag it, because these are pretty cool. If you have any experience with these 1980s vintage Japanese refractor telescopes, please tell me all about it in the comments down below. And also, be sure to like if you have the chance. Clear skies, everybody.